We'd like to welcome you tonight to the Waterloo Ice House on a beautiful Good Friday. Will you please give a warm Austin round of applause to Uncle Walt's band?
Patrick Scott Armstrong. We have a very special episode today. Okay, this is unique. I always say special, but this is unique. This is definitely the most unique episode we've done. We're sort of splicing together some interviews and music tracks and that sort of thing of who, of what I'm about to tell you right now. Okay, so look, in 1982, there was a live recording from the trio Walter Hyatt, Champ Hood, and David Ball. Who are they? Uncle Walt's band. Now, there is a re-release, remastered, expanded reissue, okay, from Omnivore Recordings of that fateful night. All right. So basically, that's it. There's a re-release of an album that Uncle Walt's band recorded, and we're going to talk about that. So I have an exclusive interview with David Ball. That's right, the last living member of Uncle Walt's band. And we have a very special guest. Okay, more about that later. All right, so with David Ball, look, we got him on the phone, so he doesn't do Zoom, okay? He doesn't do interviews, so, but we got this done, guys, because this is a very, important album, I feel, and just an important band. I mean, any musician you talk to, Uncle Walt's band's like, oh my God, I mean, they are cult as cult gets, and just like, they influence so many people. That is absolutely true. So, again, if you don't know about them, you're about to find out. And if you do, this is going to be very exciting. So look, they sent us a press release a little bit about, explaining a little bit more about, the album re-release. So I'm going to read a little bit of that. Okay. First, and then we'll get into some more. All right. Originally released as a private pressing in 1982 on the band's own Les Pedeza label, which, by the way, we talk about where that name came from in the podcast. All right. Recorded Live, which was the name of the original album that they released, okay, back in 1982 again, was a document of their legendary shows at Waterloo Ice House in Austin, Texas. All right, and this podcast is about that, okay? We talk about those legendary shows back then. It's awesome. All right, with David Ball and a special guest, which I'll mention later. All right. While those shows began around 9:30 and often continued past 2, only 14 tracks recorded over 4 nights were made available to share the magic of the 3 virtuoso singers and players. All right. Now, after releasing the anthology and expanded versions of their self-titled debut and its follow-up, An American in Texas, Omnivore Recordings will present a reimagined version of Recorded Live. So now it's titled Recorded Live at Waterloo Ice House. All right. So this collection has been expanded to 21 tracks, all right, with 7 songs from the original release, all right, so 7 from the original 14, 4 previously unissued alternate takes, wow, and a whopping 10 previously unissued performances. Okay, guys, so this album is, like, honestly pretty kick-ass, to be frank with you. So the new package features, look, photos, ephemera, new liner notes from Peter Blackstock. All right. He's a music writer for the Austin American Statesman here in Austin. And, restoration and mastering from Grammy winning engineer Michael Graves. And I can tell you, I've listened to all the tracks. They sound ridiculously good. I mean, they have just been beefed up. It's hard to describe. Talk to David Bell about that. Like, how the tracks were just so powerful. You know, they really took them in, like, But at the same time, you're not missing any of the authenticity, any of the originality. It's like you're there. Honestly, you close your eyes, you put on that album, it's like you're back there. It's pretty cool, pretty great, to be honest with you. So, all right. So look, Recorded Live at Waterloo Ice House helps paint a bigger, wider picture of Uncle Walt's band in their prime and certainly in their element. All right. Tracks from this collection, all right, have been performed, recorded by Shelby Lynn, Twang Twang, Shaka Boom, Kelly Willis, Bruce Robinson, Sean Colvin, Christine Albert, Gary P. Nunn, Jimmy Dale Gilmore, Junior Brown, and Jimmy LaFave. All right, so look, this is just, it's just an amazing episode, okay? Got to be honest with you. So, all right, again, we have a special guest coming up. All right. Before I'll let you know who that is before we get into this. But before we get into the interview, all right. And look, we're also going to be listening to some clips of the tracks too, to get you guys excited about it. Before we get to that, we're going to have a quick word from our sponsor, Texas Real Food. All right. We'll be right back. The Lone Star Play podcast is produced by Texas Real Food. Go to texasrealfood.com and you can search your city for stores, butchers, restaurants, farmers markets, and more who are using fresh, artisanal, organic sources. It's a fun site that brings all natural options all together. All right, guys, let's play a clip from one of my favorite songs on this re-release here, okay? This is Just a Little Understanding from Uncle Walt's band.
Tonight I find my reasons all are blind. How do I ask her? Why can't I tell her all I feel inside? All I have's not all I need. All I want is for her.
Let's get to this interview, okay? As always, check us out on social media, Lone Star Plate TX, our YouTube channel, The Lone Star Plate, and of course, for everything else, thelonestarplate.com. Please subscribe, like, or follow, and thank you so much, as always, for supporting us. All right, so our special guest is Gary P. Nunn. That's right. So I got a chance to talk to Gary Nunn about, you know, this movement as well before I talked to David Ball, actually. So there's going to be a little bit of Gary Nunn first, all right? Then we're going to go to David Ball afterwards, all right? And I'm going to come back after the Gary Nunn interview to help lead us into that. So first, let's start with a little bit of this Gary Nunn interview, all right? Let's enjoy.
They rehearsed relentlessly. You know, Steve Clark, who opened the first Waterloo Ice House originally, was their great supporter and benefactor. He had a store that he opened up in downtown Austin where he catered to, you know, lunch and after work business, you know, for downtown office workers. And it was a two-story building, an older building downtown, and the whole upper level, you know, he made available to them to rehearse, and I suppose they could stay and sleep up there if they wanted to, but I never went up there, but I know that you know, he made that space available to him, which is, you know, for a working band, that's
everything,
quite an asset, you know, to have those facilities, and then just, you know, move the equipment downstairs and do the show at night, and they did perform there on a regular basis. But Steve Clark, you know, was just this wonderful guy and still is. But I think he sold his Waterloo Ice House. He eventually opened several around town. But
yeah,
that was the one where, you know, he focused on having music shows.
Do you think that that's really a key to their success, was them just practicing so much and rehearsing so much and just playing together so much behind the scenes that when they did it live, it was like nothing, you know?
Right. Oh, I'm sure it contributed, you know, a great deal to, you know, their performances and of course that, you know, when you have that at your disposal, it frees you up to not have to think about, oh, where are we going to rehearse or where are we going to get together? Or you can get together at your house, my house, and all that. So it you know, it just frees you up of a lot of extra effort to get that rehearsal done.
You know, that's such a great point that I don't think fans understand if they've never played music or whatever, you know, that is a big issue for musicians, is finding a place to rehearse, especially if you got a band and, you know, loud sounds. It's like you can't just do it anywhere and you're constantly, you know, lugging equipment around. And like you said, can we do it here right. and there? Or can we, you know, go over your house? And no, my, you know, my wife is like, yeah. you know, we got to get out of the garage and, you know, we got to find a space. And then now you're putting down money for a monthly, you know, becomes part of a bill now for the yeah. band and, you know, yada, yada. Right. So yeah, that's, you're right. That's amazing, a huge help.
Amazing distraction, you know, so, you yeah. know, you just get up and coffee and have breakfast and go to work.
That's awesome. That's so great. So
it's tremendous. I know from my own standpoint right now, you know, of course, all my guys, you know, they have families and wives and kids, you know, so it's practically impossible to get them together anywhere, you know.
Sure. Because,
you know, say, well, how much is this rehearsal going to pay?
Yeah, exactly. You know, yeah.
So all that is a tremendous benefit for them and sure. helped them along greatly. Plus, they had a popular venue there to perform in, so they could, you know, generate some income as well.
Yeah, it's just like a compounding interest, being able to rehearse Absolutely. And perform right there, and it just built on itself, you know, massively. And yeah, what a great thing. And you know, it's also a different dynamic, and it's not like a full band. You know, you've got three people that are sort of leading the way, right? And finding a way to come together and, you know, do you think there was any sort of, you know, maybe somebody didn't want to be a lead or didn't want to be up in the limelight, or was that ever an issue there? Or, you know, I know that's a lot that bands have to deal with all the time.
Yeah, absolutely. I think in their case, David Ball and Champ, sort of recognized Walter as the leader.
Mm-hmm.
I'm speculating here, you know,
sure.
And so, you know, they were creative and songwriting and wonderful musicians and singers in their own right.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's hard for one guy, you know, to create enough material and put a band together to do his own show. But when you have three very, very talented people that are like-minded, they come from the same part of the country and they're into the same kind of music and they're contributing their own songs, you know, there was room for everybody, but to shine, and they all did. They traded around, but I just think, you know, Walter stood in the center and well, sometimes because David was taller, and sometimes I guess probably for visual effect, they might have set him up in the center, you know, so he'd have
sure.
a symmetry in the image of it. But
yeah,
but I'm pretty sure that, you know, they, you know, deferred somewhat, not totally submissiveness, of course, but, you know, deferred to his leadership, and it was his band, I suppose. It had his name on it, but they were all very much a part of it.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can't, you know, what it would have been like in those days to see them live and just seeing that grow. And, you know, there's a great quote that I got here. I'm going to read to you, Gary. Let me see if I find it here. Okay. So from Jerry Jeff Walker, look at that. It says, I would go see Uncle Walt's band at the Waterloo Ice House, drink scotch and soda, listen to Walter sing Ruby, and everything was all right.
Uh-huh.
So, right. Like that's such a, first of all, such a Texan thing to say. It's so simple, but it means so much, you know, and the effect. There's just so much said in that, you know, just relaxing. It makes everything go away. You know, you think about a tough day at work or whatever, a tough day, and boom, to, you know, to hear something like that and have it change you. And wow, just to be around in those times.
Right. Well, you know, their music, you say relaxing, you know, their whole persona, of course, they were just the sweetest, nicest, and very handsome, you know, young men, and of course had a lot of appeal to women, of course.
Sure.
but they were married. Well, I don't know if Champ was married at that time, but he did get married during that time. And David got married, and eventually Walter, he married a girl named Mary Lou, and that didn't work out, and eventually he married Heidi, which is, you know, Heidi is carrying the ball for this whole project, and, you know, she's carried the torch for Walter to keep his music and memory alive all these years. And
that's awesome.
It's just really, you know, it's a great culmination of all that effort and persistence and sure. determination to have this project finally come to fruition, and they're out promoting it. Then, of course, that's what we're doing here today.
Yeah.
Anyhow, Patrick, I appreciate you so much, and I look forward to shaking your hand, looking in your eye. I'll be happy for David to hear it, and I'll send my best wishes and greetings out to him as well while I have the opportunity. You know, I probably haven't seen David, you know, since he left Austin and went to Nashville.
Wow. So how many years is that, you think?
Years? Oh, it was in probably in the mid-80s or
no way. Later 80s. You haven't seen him since the mid-80s?
Not since he left town. I have.
Wow.
I've seen him on TV. But.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Let's play a clip from the album again. Here we go. This is a song called Bye Bye Baby.
I said bye. I tell my baby, baby bye. Be this kind, but I'm through with this jealousy. I see what you did to me, baby.
All right, guys, now it's that was a great, you know, interview with Gary. Now it's time for our featured interview, right, with David Ball. I hope y'all enjoy. Again, this was an exclusive and just such a pleasure to talk to David about Uncle Walt's band and their influence on the music industry and this great re-release of this album. So please go out and get this album. Yeah, we'll have all the links and everything in the description so you can get the album. And yeah, just thank you so much for sticking around. All right, let's get to it. Mr. David Ball.
Hello.
Hello, David. This is Patrick.
Hey, Patrick.
How are you doing, sir?
I am fine. How are you?
I am doing very well, actually. I've been listening to your music for days, and I've had, it puts me in such a great mood. I'm not going to lie. I mean, I really, really mean that, especially this morning. Just what music can do to you, right?
Well, I've heard that about, you know, I had old guys that ran bars and nightclubs, and they said, yeah, I like that first record you guys did. I put it on in the morning, and it would put me in such a good mood.
Yeah.
So that's great. Yeah.
Yeah.
Not that you're an old club owner or nothing. But.
Oh, I'm getting old. You know, I feel I'm getting old. I'm 41. I'm sure that's nothing, but it definitely feels different. You know, that's for
does
sure.
it? I don't. You know, I just missed all of that.
Hey, that's good.
I'm starting to feel. I'm 67, and I'm starting to feel it.
Hey, that's a good sign for me. Headed that way, then
it's not so bad. It's
no, not bad. At all. Not at all. Absolutely.
You keep your eyesight and keep your. You know, are you in Austin, Texas, right now?
I actually just moved from Austin this past weekend. I'm in Dallas now.
Oh, right.
I was in Austin for almost a decade.
Yeah, yeah. I think we did about 10 years down there. And I, you know, of course, I look back on it. It was just miraculous. I loved it. I loved it. Everything about it. You know, it was great.
When's the last time you've been to Austin?
Oh, I get down there every now and then, really about once every 2 or 3 years. But it's difficult. It's
sure.
always hard. So I don't try to go, but if something comes up and, you know, everybody wants to go do it, I'll go. And we've played, you know, Warren Hood, Marshall Hood, you know, Warren is Champ's son.
Yeah.
Champ Hood. And so we'll play some shows every now and then. And we played Dallas, I think, and, you know, different places.
But sure, of course. How has Austin changed since you guys? I mean, let's say this record, for instance, right?
It's just not as cool, man. You know, since Uncle Walt's bad. I can't help it.
I love that. I love that. It's just not as cool. That's the perfect answer.
It's not as cool, baby.
That's literally the most perfect answer I've ever heard for that. It really is. Because most people go into like a 30-minute diatribe of all the changes and this and that. And that's the best answer. In fact, I'm stealing that, David. I'm sorry, but I'm stealing that answer. I love that. That's so great.
Well, there's some truth to that.
Sure.
Say it kind of kidding, but
no
yeah, it was always very cool scene, very cool people all across the board, you know, and just Texans in general, you know.
Sure.
They just have a good thing going.
Why Austin? Why did you guys pick Austin of all places?
We were kept invited. We were living in Nashville, and we'd been up out of South Carolina, and we all made the commitment, moved to Nashville. We had a friend here, Marshall Chapman from Spartanburg, and she was in the music business, and we came up and lived here for about a year, and we're starving to death, and we kept meeting. We were kind of a folk band, really.
Yeah.
That was our setup.
Yeah.
You know, we played acoustically, and we, you know, Walter was definitely a bona fide folk musician. He knew all that stuff, and Champ and I were kind of learning it, and so we started meeting these, you know, folkies from Texas are musicians, and they kept saying, you got to come to Austin. So we did, and really wound up, it was just totally the opposite, you know, the whole deal was saying, you know, you could really play a whole lot live, and that's what we wanted to do. So Austin fit us perfectly.
Yeah.
Even though we were a little bit different than, you know, most Texas type bands.
Sure.
In Austin, that kind of worked to our favor, I think, because
you stuck out a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah. And the harmony, you know, we were really into that.
Yeah.
Three people singing.
Yeah.
And, you know, I would go hear these other bands, and there would be like 10 musicians on stage, and they would have one singer and three fiddles and no harmony, or, you know, but It was really great. We had a great time.
No, I love that. You know, what's funny is, like, from a fan perspective, let's say just somebody who knows nothing about music, can't play an instrument, can't write a song. No. When you listen to a song, what do? You remember the lyrics. You remember the voice, right? Like, that's what sticks with you. So the vocal part of it, adding harmony, I mean, that's important, because that's actually what most people listen to. You sort of groove to the music, but you sing along to the words, right? So I think that's important to have.
Right. Harmonies. Some people, they don't even know why. They don't even know what harmony is.
Yeah, that's true.
It's like, we've had people say, yeah, you guys all three sing at the same time. Why do you?
Like, I never, that's funny. Why do y'all sing at the same time? Why don't you take turns, right? That's funny.
Yeah. So we started, knocking that off a little bit. We didn't want to be labeled, you know, man.
Sure.
No labels.
No labels. Absolutely. Yeah. So that's interesting. So when you guys are playing, if anyone sort of tried to put you guys in a box, where you guys like, nope, we need to change things up. We gotta shock them with a song or something.
Right. Right. Exactly. There was nothing off limits.
Yeah.
If I casually would mention I liked a certain song, no matter how, you know, the total opposite of what we were doing or trying to do.
Yeah.
Champ and Walter, I remember one time I mentioned just casually that I like this song called Hot Fun in the Summertime.
I love that song.
Well, there you go. But you know, it wasn't in our bag, you know.
Sure.
We weren't playing that kind of stuff. Well, they worked it up. And so we didn't play it often, but we played it, you know, maybe five or six times.
That's amazing.
It was interesting. See, we were adventurous, and you could be back then, you know, they got a kick out of it. And the three of us being from Carolina, a lot of, you know, the mainstream music in Carolina was kind of beach music.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't
yes.
know that.
Under the Boardwalk and
okay.
You know, Mary Wells when yeah. I was in junior high school, all that early music like that was really big over there. Dance, you know, and see, Uncle Walt's band, we weren't really mainstream. We didn't, you know, because Walter, he wasn't into that type of, he didn't grow up in that world, that real, you know, it's just a different crowd. You know how
sure.
when you grow up, everybody's in a crowd. So
sure.
Walter somehow was able to grow up in this kind of intellectual folk crowd, almost like it was like a throwback. You know, that was one thing people said about Uncle Walt's bands, like they're like from a different era.
That and, that's awesome. What a compliment.
That's because of the way Walter, yes, yes. And he, Walter even spoke. He later told me that in their house growing up, they got to watch TV for 1 hour. And that's it.
1 hour a day.
1 hour a day.
Yeah.
And so when Walter would talk, he spoke very slowly. And it's kind of like, you know, my grandparents and old people. You think they're talking slow because they're old, but that's the way I think people spoke back then, you know? It's,
yeah.
Before everything was radio and TV.
Sure. Yeah, oh, I see.
Spoke, yeah,
oh,
it's kind
that's
of a draw.
Interesting. Okay.
It
so
is
it's sort
interesting.
Of, that is interesting. Yeah. So it sort of sped up conversation when you add you're right, because they're talking faster, they get, and then it just sort of bleeds into society and culture and how people speak and communicate.
Yes, it does.
Yeah, you're right. Wow, that's interesting.
That and is. See, even though that had ended, because Walter kind of had this delay, his family, they you know, they lived out, they lived in a log cabin, and
oh wow,
they had horses and stuff, and they were still in that time zone, kind
sure.
of. And it was great. You know, it was just great. That's where we used to rehearse over there. And they were just very genteel, Southern, kind of quiet, but very, Walter was always kind of very brainy, you know, he was always
yeah.
kind of thinking and writing and working on songs. It was pretty exotic stuff.
Was he like the type to just bring up stuff, you know, even outside of music, just thinking about stuff, you know, just what about this and what about that? You know what I mean? Just contemplating things. Was he that type of guy?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
And, you know, just he loved
people like that are fascinating.
Know, language and poetry
yeah.
and,
yeah, that's awesome.
You know, music. And
sure.
I think he kind of got it from his family. They were all very talented people.
Yeah. Wow, that's amazing. That's amazing.
Yeah, well, it was different.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, what's funny is I was, you know, talking earlier about listening to the, you know, the record this morning and getting myself going and whatever. I've been listening to it for days, but, you know, one thing I noticed that hit me today, in fact, was just how good the quality is on these recordings. It honestly sounds, I don't know if this is negative or not, but it almost sounds like it's in the studio. Like I can't even tell it's live until I hear an audience clap or something. Like it sounds so crisp and good. And it sounds like you're right next to me singing. I mean, I can't explain it. It's unbelievable. It really
well,
is unbelievable.
That's fantastic. Yes. I thought, you know, Omnivore got a hold of this and they can do nowadays amazing stuff. They made our first record that we cut
yeah.
in Charlotte, which did
That's
sound
right.
good. They made it sound even better.
Wow.
This live record always kind of bothered me because I always thought of it as a board tape. You know, it didn't
sure.
have any ambiance.
A board
Boom.
Tape.
Omnivore gets a hold of it and they sweetened it up. They didn't tune it. That's us and it's live. But they just kind of fattened it up. You know, we all had pickups on our little acoustic instruments. And I remember really not liking the way some of those instruments sound. They sound, you know, they can get a little thin.
Sure.
But Omnivore, you know, they run it through the mastering process, and it it improves it. So whatever I really appreciate that.
Yeah, yeah. Whatever they did, the magic technology, right, in 2021 here, that's amazing. Because almost, you know, salvages it, I guess, in a sense. Like you said, it fattens it up. It doesn't take away from the original feeling and emotion of those songs, right? It just amps. It almost just transports you back, like if you were literally live there, you know, in it, really feeling everything, and the bass and the song and the instruments sound great. I mean, they really did a number on those too. So, yeah,
well, that's
amazing.
See, I was kind of the tech guy in Uncle Walt's band. That was
right on.
You know, I had to. I was into that.
You always those checking everybody's.
They had no idea. If you left Jeff and Walter alone, they one time went up to Charlotte, North Carolina to buy a PA. And so they wanted me to come up there and look at it. And Walter, for some reason, everything he bought, he wanted to buy it on time. He was big into that. You know, it would be like, well, we're gonna pay $39 a week. And I was like, what are you? But I go up there and look at this thing, and it was like they had found a PA that was called something like the Exterminator. I mean, it was just this big, huge. It was totally the opposite of what Uncle Walt's band, you know, that one 15-inch bass speaker and then a big horn and a white fiberglass, and it was made by Heil.
Wow.
Which they make, you know, steamrollers and bulldozers and stuff. And I just thought, you guys are out of your
luck. You're like,
no, I think the reason Walter liked it is because they put together a deal, you know, so he liked to make the payment.
Yeah, that is so, you're like, I can't leave you guys alone for 1 minute.
Right. Like, and I was just a kid, but I knew PA, you know, that was one thing I did have a little bit of knowledge about that. So I appreciate, that was one of my goals when we did that first record, was that if somebody, you know, back then there were things called audiophile magazines, and you could read these magazines, and I was into it. And they would review music, and they would talk about, you know, especially if like some jazz record on Blue Note or something, they'd talk about how the sonic, the sound, the range of the sound of the bass, whatever. And I wanted Uncle Walt's band to do kind of this folky record that would be reviewed, you know, because it would sound so good. That's a big part of, you know, the music. And we certainly had the ability, like when we would rehearse over in Walter's log cabin out there, it just sounded wonderful. And that was the sound that, you know, we tried to create in the studio, but it can get a little dicey, you know, sometimes. But
sure.
So the first record, we almost got there, but you know, we went in and knocked that record out in about 6 hours straight. And,
oh wow!
You know, it's hard for an engineer to keep up because everything was moving around. You know, well, who's singing the lead on that? Well, we don't know. We don't. You know, just hang on, Daddy.
Yeah, just hang on. We're gonna figure this out. I love that. That was
like, what's the name of this particular number you're gonna play now? I don't know what it's called, but it's a gooder.
You know what's funny is, like, I think fans are gonna love this because it's like you guys were who you were all the time. Right. Like, you know what I mean? It wasn't a show that y'all, I mean, it's a show you're putting on court, but it wasn't an act that you were putting on, you know, in that sense, right? Yeah. Where you're different than who you are up on the stage. I love that. That's amazing. That's so amazing.
Well, that's exactly right. You know, and that can work against you, but at the same time, when it's happening, it's really good. I think that's part of, you know, what Uncle Walt's band fell into. That's just, you know, we all knew each other so well. So, you know, the minute, you know, somebody starts to pull some crap or something, it's over.
Yeah.
You know, it's not going to happen. So what I used to love was when we would have some, you know, some record exec come down and, you know, want to listen to the band or something like that. Why? Walter would just get off into the most bizarre, you know, you just never knew what was going to happen. And most of those people left our shows just like, I don't get it. Who are these people? They're from where? They're from North Carolina? What? You know, just nothing made sense.
Oh my God.
But it was fun. It was fun.
I bet he enjoyed that probably, right? That they left like that. I mean, I bet that's what he was going for.
I think there was a certain amount of mischievousness.
Sure.
In Walker and Champ, you know, and I was so young and green when I was hanging around them. I didn't know if they were putting me on or not, you know, but they certainly had their fun with me, I guess. So.
Yeah, that's part of being in a group.
That's part of it. Yeah. That is part of it. Yeah. Sure. So we certainly did it.
You know, they mentioned this stuck out to me, that people compared watching y'all you know, during that time in Austin to like watching the Beatles back when they were in the cavern, I think it was called, or something like the Cavern House or something in England.
Oh yeah.
I found that fascinating, and I can totally understand the similarity, to be frank with you. Like, I really can. I can see it. And that's awesome. I mean, what a compliment. That's like, you know, people were part of a movement. And the best part about what I read is that they knew they were in the moment. That's even better. So then you know to remember it, right? And really just live it. You know what I mean? Because honestly, a lot of times life is in hindsight, right? Or retrospect, or, you know, you look back and you go, wow, I wish I would have enjoyed that more. Or if I knew what it was at the time, you know, those sorts of things. So that's kind of cool to hear that the people knew watching y'all, wow, this is special. This is not something we're used to. This is not something that's going to come around again. And we're going to, you know what I mean? Enjoy this. That's just incredible. I just think that's.
Yeah. Like I say, Austin couldn't have been a better place.
That's,
you know,
great.
There were a few folk clubs here and there and small, listening rooms. There was a good one in Houston and Dallas. So, yeah, it was fun. And that was kind of the style for a number of years. And I think really what kind of brought it to, you know, the disco and different types of music all of a sudden, you know, just became very... mainstream, and we kept kind of pushing Uncle Walt's band to become mainstream, but there were a few songs out there and a few bands that were similar to what we were doing, and it was kind of heading that way, but that didn't last very long, you know. It just poof, and next thing you know, everything was kind of I can remember when punk rock kind of came in, and I just thought,
oh wow,
well, you know, that's a
wow,
and to have success with that in Austin, Texas, I was like, what do you got to be so mad about? You know, because I mean, Austin, Texas was paradise, you know.
Wow.
It was just
wow.
They had the swimming and the water, you know, the neighborhoods had little swimming pools. And then if you wanted to go to, God, we lived at Barton Springs. And
oh, wow. Wow.
And then if you wanted to get on the big water, you know, Lake Travis was out there.
Yep.
It was all very accessible. I loved it.
Yeah, you're making me miss it now that I just left. Now I'm thinking about, I'm like, dang, what did I do? Why did I leave Austin? No, my family's up here. It just made more sense to be close to my family. But yeah, you're right. Austin is definitely just a phenomenal city. Like you said, you know, what's funny is people always say, I mean, really every like 5 years, people say, well, Austin isn't what it used to be, you know? So I just stop even thinking about that sort of thing. But, you know, during that time when you guys are playing in Austin at the Waterloo, what was Waterloo like at that time? You know, cause it's still, you know what I mean? I mean, it's, you sort of still around and it's been around a long time. That's such a fascinating, and why that place to do this live recording? Like why that place? Is it just because you guys play there all the time and that was just, you know, we're going to do it here?
Well, the Waterloo came along a little bit later. We had gone back to Carolina for a couple of years and goofing around and wound up coming back to Austin, and they were just opening this place on Congress Avenue.
Yeah.
And it would hold about 120 people. And I was down there playing in some other band, and they played at the Waterloo. And I thought, well, this would be great. Champ and Walter would come on. And so they did.
Wow.
And we started playing at the Waterloo, and it, you know, it was just a big old building, and it acoustically it sounded really cool. And Uncle Walt's band was not really a bar band. We were more of a listening room, and Waterloo kind of fit that. We could play in there without any mics. We could play to about 100 people.
Oh, wow.
And yeah. And we built a stage so that, you know, you could just enough. And we sat up in the middle of the, kind of in the middle of the room. And it was a lot of fun. And people were quiet. You know, they would really listen in
there.
That's
amazing. That's amazing.
So especially in the, you know, February, January, when it would kind of slow down, we would play there, you know, a couple of times a week, I think, you know.
What do you remember twice. About those recordings? Do you remember anything crazy about that?
We were kind of had more or less, it was sort of toward the tail end of Uncle Walt's band, because we were all going in different directions, and I think it was just a big last final effort.
Yeah.
Because we knew that we could play live, and making records was always, you know, yeah, it was good, you know, but we wanted to do it. People kept saying, when are you going to do a live record? Because y'all are so much better live. Well, that's because you put us on a record, you can't see us.
Yeah, good point. Exactly.
I think what they wanted was a movie. We should have made a movie.
Hey, like the Beatles, right? The Beatles, they made a movie too. Yeah, love that. That's funny.
Yeah, we could even use that script and just insert our faces.
Oh man, that would actually be quite hilarious, to be honest with you.
I think that would be funny. I think that would be a good idea.
Right, a hard waltz night. That's what we call it.
Hey, keep working on that, okay?
Yeah. Yeah, we'll put that on the notes over here to continue that. Yeah.
You got it.
That's funny. That's crazy.
I don't know. You know, it was, we drew a lot of people from that had gone to UT, but Austin is such a great place that people, you know, once they got out of school, they just stayed and they figured out a way, something to do. A lot of people had restaurants and, you know, just did whatever. You did whatever you wanted to do. And that's who got to come see us. They were become regulars, you know, because they had a lot of free time. And there were a lot of those kind of people in Austin, you know, they just hanging out and enjoying life. And I think Uncle Walt's band somehow, you know, that's what we were into. We would put a big old piece of life out on your plate and say, enjoy.
I love
because,
that.
You know, you always meet people in the audience, you know, and they'll come up and tell you, you know, what music means to them or what, you know,
sure.
And then they'll talk about their life. And, you know, sometimes it can be very sad, but
sure. Yeah.
If you can just play some music for them, music has the ability, and it was always that way with me. You know, music was always listening to it as a kid. It would just take me away.
Yeah.
And I love that about it. And nothing else does that, you know.
Wow.
So I think that's why all of us were into playing music. And Walter was just a master at it. He was a great influence on me and Champ.
Yeah.
His ability to write and yet see doing all that playing, it became more and more Uncle Walt's band sort of becoming a bar band because we had to travel.
Sure.
And we had to go out and play. And well, you know, we're from Texas, so, you know, but Walter had all these songs that, you know, as far as bar music, it ain't going to happen. It's just not going to work. It's not that kind of thing. So we would try to find, coffee houses. And it'd been great if we could play theaters because that's what.
For your sound, right? For your sound.
Yes.
Yeah.
And just the way, you know, it's listening music. It was sure. Listening music.
Yeah. Yeah. That's
and after we would play, you know, I like to go out and hear some of these honky-tonk bands and stuff like that. And there was just always a lot of great music in Austin, all kinds of music. It was potent.
Yeah.
And good music. Great music. And
still
they,
is. Still is.
Yeah, yeah. They really make good sounding records down there, too. It's,
I mean, they call it the live capital music of the world, right? I don't know who gave it that title, to be honest. I'm not sure who did that.
I did.
Yeah, it was you. It was.
Yeah. Hey, it pops out of my head. You know, what can I say?
That is so funny.
I don't know.
But it's kind of true. You hear it. I mean, you go to the airport, there's music.
Is.
You go to the grocery store, they have a band playing at the grocery store. Okay, that's you don't get that anywhere else.
That's the live music capital of the world.
I mean, you're buying, you know, you're sorting through cherry tomatoes and you're listening to some, you know, good live music. It's like it's the whole thing here. Yeah, you know what else I found? You talk about all the great music in Austin. You're so right. But what made y'all so cool too is that, you know, people could go see y'all and hear a bunch of different music. Right. You're going to hear different stuff, some blues, some jazz, some this, some that. Right. Like, that's awesome. That's I think that's another facet of why people loved y'all so much. I really, really think so.
Yeah. Yeah. And back in the day, you know, it was about new, bring something new to the table. And
that's great. That's amazing.
So.
That's so amazing.
We were old school, but we were kind of trying to do new, you know, new melodic, new melodies, and
it shows.
You know, we listened to all kinds of stuff, and it you just absorb all that. You know, anything we like, we would attempt to play it. It was kind of a learning process, you know.
Sure, in front of a crowd, in a way, right? Like
in front of a crowd, right?
Yeah. And people got to be a part of that.
I remember seeing Walter and Champ. They had a duo. I knew Champ Hood and Spartanburg, and he played in a good band. They were a little older than me. And when Champ and Walter, I didn't know Walter. But they started playing as a duo, and I was in high school, and I would go and take about three or four people, and we would sit and listen to them. They played in this Italian restaurant.
I love that.
Yeah. And boy, they just were killer diller. And so then they would start, Champ knew that I've sang and played a little bit. So they start letting me kind of sit in with them. See?
Oh, wow.
And that's what, so I would get up and, you know, and they started, they would play the college a little bit. And
sure.
This and that. So, you know. I would follow them around.
Do you remember the first time? Oh, I'm sorry. No, go ahead. What were you going to say?
No. What? The first time what?
I was going to say.
Them or?
Well, the first time that y'all sang together and you realized, ooh, this is something, guys.
It was a slow, process, but,
okay.
And see, but that would have been at that Italian restaurant.
Wow.
And
shout out to anybody who got to go to that Italian restaurant and watch that happen. Oh my God.
It was very cool. And that was the place because it was like a basement. That was the place that was kind of like the cavern, you know, it was way down in this bottom of this restaurant in the bar area, and nobody was ever in there. So, you know, it was, they were just bouncing around, learning, playing. Yeah. You know, I think Champ might have been in the 11th grade. I was in the 10th grade.
Wow.
And, I think Walter was in college.
Wow.
And it was very cool, yeah. And Walter had some songs, and they made a tape. This is probably about 1968 or something. And they made a little tape, a reel-to-reel tape of some of their songs. And I thought it was fantastic. And I was pretty much a connoisseur of good music. I knew all the lyrics to some Roger Miller, King of the Road, and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Champ Hood would say, and now little David Ball is going to sing My Shoes Keep Walking Back to You. And I'd never heard this song. And they would give me up to sing a song, and I would sing something. And I said, what is this, My Shoes Keep Walking Back to You? He was just being funny. So I start looking around. I start looking around, and I find it. And it's, you know, it's pretty good. So he says that, and now here's little David. He would say that every time I'd get up and sing, and now here's little David Ball to sing, My Shoes Keep Walking Back to You. And so I get up and I go, okay, kick it off. And we did, My Shoes Keep Walking Back to You, which is kind of a, it's kind of a goofy little number, but
oh man, that is so funny. God, this sounds like such a great time. You know what I mean? Not just playing music, but just really building.
Well, they were,
you know,
the fun was watching Chap and Walter. Oh my God, they were just, it was just a mess. Just, we would get so tickled, and it was just,
God, I bet, you know, and it shows through the music though, right? Like you're relaxed, you're calm, you're in the moment, you're having fun, you know, and it comes out in the music, it comes out of the performance. It really does.
Yes.
I think so. Ah, that's so fascinating, Dave. I mean, really, that's so fascinating. You know, I got to speak to Gary Nunn. Did you know that? Did you hear that? You heard that?
Yes,
you heard that conversation, right?
I sure did.
Amazing.
I wanted to listen to that. I couldn't get it to work, but yes, Gary Nunn was had the coolest house in Austin, Texas, and he lived out near a little bit north of town, but it was a house set way back off the road.
Oh,
so
yeah.
You could go back in there, and he always had a couple of musicians living there, and you know, it was just nothing but music going on in that house, and it was always just wide open. If you happened to be in the neighborhood, you could whoop it in there, and there was always something going on there.
Wow.
And he just opened up his doors and let Uncle Walt's band come in, and took us under his wing a little bit, you know, and showed us around town. And
wow.
He liked to go to this restaurant over in East Austin. I think it was Matzel Rancho or something.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah, Matzel Rancho. Yeah, it's still around.
Was that it? They had a little glass that had mats around. I don't know.
Yeah,
it's pretty good.
It's still around. It's
pretty good.
It's literally.
Oh,
still,
is it?
Yeah, it's still open.
He was a very dapper dude.
Yeah, it's still open. Wow, I didn't know it was around that long.
And he drove a checker cab.
What?
Like a,
he had a cab?
Yeah.
That is awesome.
Big old checker. It was cool.
That is cool.
So he had transportation. He was already a successful, you know, working musician.
Yeah.
And that's what Uncle Walt's band was trying to get going. So he probably helped us with a gig or two. And, you know, Jerry Jeff, they went on to do some extraordinary things, you know, just perfect. You know, Jerry Jeff cuts that record at Luke and Bach and, you know, dragged all that equipment out there and boom, it was fantastic record. And got to stay, you know, and participate. And he just was everything about all that music that he was just the essence of it. I thought it was fantastic.
That's awesome. Yeah. He told me to tell you, obviously, you know, hello and his best regards. And, you know, he was just so excited to talk about everything. I mean, it really, really was. Well, when you hear the whole episode, you'll hear his stuff in it too. So when that happens, you'll get to hear the rest. I'm sorry that whatever, I'm sorry the file didn't open or whatever. I apologize for that. But yeah, it was, he had nothing but the greatest things to say about y'all. I mean, in fact, it was like y'all influenced him a lot, and that's what he said. Really, for real.
Well, likewise. Yeah.
He just had the utmost respect.
I understand. I was supposed to explain what Les Padiza.
Yes.
Was.
Yes. I had to, I need to ask you that. He wasn't sure where that came from.
Well, that came from Walter. You know, like I say, they were out a little bit. They had horses, and Les Padiza is like a, it was a great memory Walter had, him and his father. And they would, when they were feeding horses, that's what they fed them, this Les Padiza hay.
Oh, it's a type of hay.
Yes, grass or a hay, yeah.
That's right. Okay, I think Gary said that.
Horse feed.
Horse feed, okay, interesting. And he just liked that name.
He just liked the sound of it, and he connected it, you know, with a good memory with his dad.
Ah, that's it. That's right. That's it right there. Yeah. Okay. That makes absolute sense. Wow. That is really cool. That's a cool. A cool story. That's really cool. That's really neat. So
right around that time when Uncle Walt's band was getting together, Walter lost his father, and it was not a good situation.
Man. No, not
so
at
he,
all.
You know, he weathered the storm, but him and his dad were close, you know, and,
that's tough.
I only got to meet his father a time or two. And it was kind of odd because they lived in this log cabin way back in the woods, but his father drove a giant red convertible.
What?
Car.
That is not what I thought you were going to said when you were like giant red. I was waiting for something else, right? Not convertible.
It was a big red Oldsmobile, huge car, one of the biggest cars you could make back then.
It had a sail on it, right? It was so big.
And I always wanted to go for a ride in it, but I never did.
Oh man, that's crazy.
They had some old truck that Walter drove, and every time you'd have to jump start it. So we were always pushing that truck. And Walter, I think that's why Walter wanted me and Champ around. Push that damn truck.
He's like, we need to add some more guys to the band so we can help push the truck.
That's how I got the gig.
That's how you got the gig. Good shoulders. That's hilarious.
Yeah. I was a stout little boy.
I love that. That is so funny. All right, David. All right, little David Ball. Get back there and push the truck.
Yeah. Not much further.
Oh man, that's absolutely incredible. You know, that honestly, I wouldn't expect to hear any other thing than he had a truck like that, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Right. Like if you said something else, it wouldn't make sense. Like that makes more sense. You know, that makes absolutely the most sense.
That fits.
Yeah, that fits the whole thing, right? It's a whole that's so interesting. You know what else is interesting is you said you guys really wanted to make it mainstream, right? Like that was that Uncle Walt's. This will be sort of my last question here. We'll sort of, you know, obviously we'll talk about anything else you didn't mention, but I'm curious about that. You know, because when I was talking to Gary, it was like, you know, okay, what do I want to do with my music career? You know, how far do I want to take it? And I remember him saying, you know, I didn't want too mainstream, right? Like I wanted to still be me. I wanted to have control. I wanted to own my music, blah, blah, blah. You know, these sort of things that I totally understand from a musician's standpoint. But you know, you mentioned that earlier about Uncle Walt's band. Was y'all's dream to be like, you know, on the cover of magazines and touring the world and playing big stadiums, or what was the sort of goal?
You know, I don't really know. We didn't really talk about it, but I know that Walter especially was looking for, he wanted to go do a major record.
Yeah.
You know, so that he could explore, you know, his talent.
Sure.
he wanted to do a real, you know, with a real producer. I think playing in Uncle Walt's band, you know, as some kind of acoustic, he was good at it, but it was kind of limiting.
Sure.
And, so that, I think that was his dream. And then of course, I guess we wanted, you know, the bar, like I say, we were not a bar band and the listening rooms were kind of, so we thought, well, we need to, you know, we got to do something. And, you know, we had some rough experiences, you know, playing in bars, you know, that, you know, wanted more or less cover. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, play some Skinner.
Yeah. Freebird, right? You just hear Freebird.
Walter would be like, what's a Skinner? We had no idea.
What's a Skinner? That's a great answer.
What is he saying?
What's a Skinner? He just orders from the bar. Give us three Skinners. I don't know. I think it's a drink. Yeah. I'm not sure.
I don't know that song.
Yeah.
I don't know the Skinners.
That's so funny.
We were so bad. We totally missed the whole urban cowboy thing. I didn't even become aware of it until about 4 years later. And I was like, this happened right under our nose. What in the hell were we doing?
Y'all were in you were in your own world, you know, doing your own thing.
Yeah, we were. We were totally in our own. And so, you know, I think Walter, being the big dreamer, he wanted the world to come to him.
Yeah.
And it did. It could. I saw it, you know, many times, but that ain't going to happen in some, you know,
sure,
bar. You know, we didn't do covers. If we did covers, it would be like, you know, some Fats Domino song.
Which is great, by the way. I heard the one
they weren't going to.
Yeah. That's not what they want to hear, right? That's like you said, they want to hear Skinner. No. They want to hear whatever's, you know.
Yeah, so we started running into that.
Yeah.
It just kind of... And, you know, Walter did a record after on his own and, you know, got to explore a lot of that. And
sure.
It was pretty... I think I was the only person that liked it. It was such a change from Uncle Walt's band.
Yeah.
But, man, Walter got in. He was always into people like Anita Baker and all this kind of stuff. Sure. Yeah, he loved that stuff.
Yeah,
I'd listen to it and I'd go, "Yeah, what? Are we going to start doing this?"
He's exploring new skills.
I would try to learn to play some electric bass, and some reason I just couldn't. I couldn't get, you know, and work with a drummer. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It took me a long time to get to where I could have to find the right guy.
Sure. That makes
sense.
But
anyway, it was a long, you know, it's a funny process, man. I was just glad that we got to do a lot of it in Texas, you know, and meet all those great people out there. Cause
amazing.
A bunch of them, man, a bunch of them, and all of them, you know, just fantastic. I thought,
no, that's amazing. I'm actually looking at some of these pictures here of y'all playing at the show while you're talking to me here. You know, wow, just amazing. It just looks so amazing. Y'all look so young here too. You know.
Yeah, I guess we were.
Yeah, yeah, you were young and you know, lively and making changes and you know, sort of a mini revolution in Austin. You know, music revolution in some sense, you know, during that time. What are your, you know, speaking of this release of this, you know, this new album that's coming out, what are some of your favorite tracks that are on here? Or
the ones that surprised me that I didn't really remember that much of, and one of the first ones I heard was Eddie's Girl.
Yeah.
And we didn't play that song a whole lot. But when I heard the recording of it, and this was a Champ Hood song, and he was kind of getting into, you know, this Elvis Costello. Champ would follow some of a lot of that, you know, guitar player kind of rock stuff.
Sure.
And I thought, wow, Eddie's Girl. And I thought, that's good. That's really, really good.
No, that's a great song.
But I, you know, we had so much music, you know, we just had tons of stuff. Don't ask me, man.
Which one I put on repeat for like almost a, you know, good 40. I put it on repeat for like 45
this
minutes.
This is serious.
Like for real, like almost an hour I put on repeat. I loved the song so much. And it's actually your song, Just a Little Understanding.
That's crazy. Now, is that just me and guitar?
Yep. There's some harmony. They're singing a little bit behind you, like a little something. You know, not necessarily harmony, but some backups. I hear you know, a few oohs and ahs, you know, in the back.
It's not here. It's not a string quartet or nothing on that song.
It's beautiful. It's such a beautiful song. Again, I'm a big Beatles
fan.
Thank
you. Yeah.
It's just such a beautiful song. I mean, it's absolutely beautiful.
Well, I appreciate that. Yeah, I do.
There's so many good songs on this album. I mean, it really is. 21 tracks. It's crazy.
These weren't even, you know, we'd already put out all the big,
The main ones. Yeah, exactly.
Numbers.
Yeah, the big, exactly. The main
so this,
ones.
This was kind of the obscure.
Mm-hmm. But that's what fans are going to want. That's what fans want, right? They want this.
Well, we're going deep, man.
Yeah,
we're going deep catalog.
Exactly. We're going deep catalog, people. You know, don't be calling and writing a letter to Uncle Walt's band now, right? Like, hey, guys, they're going deep, okay? They're giving you what you want here. Yeah, this is amazing. Again, the mastering of them is phenomenal.
We're going to get a hit. I think we're going to get a hit.
Oof, I think so too, man. And honestly, I really think people are going to be blown away by again the what they've done to these songs now, like updating them and getting them again, not, you know, not eliminating the magic that made them special, but just beefing that up. I mean, it's they're really fantastic. It really is. And there's much
they do it. They really do a great job.
They did a great job, and there's just so much, you know, like you said,
that's a bit of luck to find them. I think, you know, that's just
wow. Well, that's great. That's good. Yeah, that's definitely good to hear for sure. Well, you know, like I said, there's just so many unbelievable songs on this. I mean, it's just you can't even name them.
Well, Patrick, I really appreciate it. I certainly appreciate the interview.
Oh, this has been
fantastic. This is more of a food program, though, right?
We're sponsored by a food company called Texas Real Food, and I'm a chef. So, I worked in the restaurant industry for 15 years, and I've been doing now I'm a podcaster. I mean, I've changed careers now at this point. Because this podcast started to do so well, so we're in it, you know, doing this.
That's fantastic.
I do talk about food a little bit on every podcast with anybody that wants to. I mean, everyone likes food. Everyone eats food, so you know, anybody can talk about food.
I don't like.
You'd like.
If I could get back to Austin, maybe I could renew that. But you know, up here they eat a lot of white beans, and I like white. That's the best thing they got: white beans.
White
they
beans.
Do a good
white
bean.
Okay. White bean. Interesting.
Like, I had my little
like mashed or how's it made?
Yeah, really. Who knows? I think they cook it in a toilet, right? You find an old abandoned toilet.
You find an old.
Build a fire. It's ceramic, man. It's ceramic. Okay.
These sound like prison white beans. That's what this sounds like. This is like.
Yeah. You eat it out of a tin pan.
Yeah.
You squat. That should be your next restaurant. You call it the squat. Primitive. Primitive eating.
Primitive.
Hey man, have you seen where they just put the meat right on the coal? They throw the meat right on the fire.
Yeah.
I'm going to try that.
Yeah. Get it on the fire.
Put it on the,
That's interesting.
What do you do?
On the fire, on the coals. I don't know if I've seen that.
Yeah, you're the chef, not me. Don't come to me.
I mean, I guess there are some that might do that, but you're going to get your food all ashy. I don't know. Who knows?
Yes.
You know,
that's what you would think. I'll do it, and I'll give you a full report.
I expect it, you know, 10 pages, 1,000 words. No, I'm kidding.
Yes.
Well,
it'll be a lot more than that.
Yeah.
It's going to be an entire volume set of books.
Volume set. Yeah, you're like, this is round one. Okay. Yeah. I love it. That's hilarious. Well, David, I can't tell you how much, just how fantastic this has been speaking to you. I've cried laughing a couple times during this. I wasn't expecting to do that, to be honest with you.
Well, that's Uncle Walt's band, man. Yeah,
totally. 100%. You brought the energy. You brought the Uncle Walt's energy to the interview, which is fantastic. And people are going to absolutely love this. I can't wait to piece this all together.
Well, it was a pleasure. It was a real pleasure, man.
I appreciate that, David. Yeah, this
I do too. You enjoy that Dallas, Texas. You're still in Texas, you know.
Oh yeah, I'm never leave Texas. I have moved out and come, but I always come back. I always come back. You know, brings me back. That's where I grew up. I'm from Texas. I grew up here, so you know, it's hard to. Texas just always pulls you back. It's something about the state.
Yeah.
So,
you know
what I'm talking about. So,
I know where the carp are biting.
Yeah, that's right. Well, listen, David, again, this is just absolutely fantastic. You know, thank you so much just, you know, from us and from the fans, for doing this and, you know, and for releasing this re-release here. This is very exciting.
Well, thanks. Thank you, man. No, thank you. Thanks for what you do. I think it's great.
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much, David. I hope you, you know, enjoy the rest of your day. And, you know, I hope you're staying safe out there with everything going on with COVID and all that. So, please stay safe out there.
You Good. Do the same.
Thank you so
stay
much.
Stay in touch.
Thank you so much, all right. David. All right, brother. We'll talk soon. Okay.
Bye.
Bye-bye. All right, guys. Thank you so much for listening. Wanted to play one more final clip of a song before we head out. Okay. This song is called If I Don't Stop Crying.
If I don't stop crying, I know I'm gonna bring down rain. Oh, if baby says somebody loves you, nobody gonna take your place.